As a postgraduate, you think that reading is as important as practical
search? Both are important. I think reading is important because you now want to know more of the indications. You want to know when to go in, when not to go in. And it is as important, and as you learn technique, you will realize that by reading you can apply these techniques. Maybe later I will tell you how I applied those techniques when I came to Meenakshi Mission Hospital, but you can apply those techniques.
I'm so glad today to be with Dr. Ramesh Arthanari, and who's a renowned surgical gastroenterologist and no stranger to any student of surgery in across India. He's not just an accomplished GI surgeon, but an accomplished endoscopist, an accomplished laparoscopist, as well as a robotic surgeon. And more than anything, he is a teacher par excellence, and he is the most sought after speaker in any of the surgical conferences. And I've seen him in every airport possible. He lives out of a suitcase, and I wonder how he could develop his unit to this extent while traveling. Thank you, sir, for spending time with us, and I'll take some good time from you. Where do you exactly belong to?
I was born in the town of Salem, which is where my mother comes from. My father comes from a town called Tiruchengodu, which is just close to Salem. But after being born, my father at that time was working in those days Bihar, present Jharkhand, at a place called Sindri. Sindri was the first public sector undertaking by the government of India. In 1952, it was opened.
The fertilizer.
It's fertilizers.
Okay.
And my father was a chemical engineer, and he was working there. So I spent my entire childhood in Sindri. Mm-hmm. We would come home for vacation to see my grandparents and other things. But I did my schooling in that place. And I lived in this colony. It was a unique colony in the sense that we had people from every part of India, Bengal, Orissa, Andhra, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Punjab. So we had, it was really cosmopolitan. And because of that, we formed easy friendships. We didn't get any prejudices. I was also lucky that just about 12 kilometers from where I, in this colony, we had a Jesuit school. So it was a Jesuit school which had been started, and when we studied, it was still being run by American Jesuits. So we had a lot of Americans who spent almost their entire life in that area. The school was called Dinobli School.
Okay.
And it was a Society of Jesus.
The Loyola College.
Like Loyola College, yes. So, being an American school, their approach to education was very different from other schools which I used to see at that time. So, every day we had a sports day, and we had to compulsorily play sports. The fathers would come in their tracksuit and they would play football, hockey. And the school had two football grounds, two cricket grounds. In some weather, it would be converted to a hockey ground. We had basketball court. We had two tennis courts. So we had all the facilities for games. Plus, we had a lot of facilities for extracurricular activities. So I learned in school how to take photographs. And in those days, how to develop the black and white negative, how to print it on a photographic paper at home. And there was aero modeling club, there was elocution club, there was debating club. There was a magazine where people who wanted to write for the monthly magazine could get together and they would edit it. It was all done by students. So we got not just a schooling, but a real education. And you can imagine the quality of the school that nowadays, if I find a single student from Madurai getting into IIT or something, they immediately put it in the paper as a big achievement. We were a school of where in each batch we had, I think, about 80 students. And every year, which I remember when I was there, we would have 5-6 students who get into IIT. Or one or two students would get into medicine in Vellore or in Chipmer, Pondicherry. So we somehow never thought that these were great achievements, because the way of teaching was different. We were encouraged to read on our own. And just a small example, that being a Jesuit school, they used to have this moral science class. The reason for the moral science class was that the Catholic students would be taken away for what is known as a catechism class. They would be taught every week twice. So the rest of us, instead of just sitting around, they used to teach us moral science. And in our 10th and 11th, we had a Father Montwell from USA who came to take moral science class for us. And he said, look, we are not going to discuss moral science. And then he put up a book and said, this book we'll read over the next 2 years. It is a book which you would have heard of. It is called Future Shock by Alvin Toffler. Mm-hmm. And we read that book. And it was a book that changed many of our opinions. And for the first time, we realized that what we are going to learn may not be everything that we will always be using, but that there will be new things. And that is what Future Shock is actually about, that there will be so much of information knowledge. And in 1973, when he wrote the book, Alvin Toffler predicted that the great industries of the 21st century will not be oil or aeroplanes or cars, but it will be information technology. Before the birth of Google, before the birth of Facebook, he had made this prediction. So he was very prescient. And he also said that the illiterates of the 21st century will be those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. So, and that is precisely what you and I have done. We started in an age when the only surgery we knew was how to open with a knife. We had to make big incisions, and we were taught big surgeons make big incisions. But then came the era of minimal access surgery, and we started doing holes to do the operation. Then came endoscopic surgery, and we started going through natural orifices and performing many of the operations that were routinely done by minimal access or open endoscopically. And we saw this tremendous, we have been fortunate that we saw this tremendous change from what we learned to what we do. What I do today and what you do today is nothing in gastroenterology. In that, GI surgeons, I think, have been more fortunate than many other specialties, because in many of the other specialties, like cardiothoracic surgery, urology, the surgical specialties seem to have taken a back seat. But in GI surgery, with the addition of all this, we seem to have still been able to survive and dominate. So that was my schooling.
How did you get into medicine? Where did this seed?
The seed came basically in that small town where I grew up. There's a gentleman whose name I should tell, whose son was my classmate in school from first standard to 11th standard. The son holds the Qualcomm chair of electrical engineering at University of California, San Diego. And there is a Qualcomm institute with 7 floors, with 40 faculty and over 200 PhD students, and he's the director of that institute. His father was from Madurai. Unfortunately, he wanted to be a doctor, and his grandfather was a leading practitioner in Madurai in medicine, but he died at a young age. So he was not able to take up his, and so he did some other courses and then started working in this small government organization. But he wanted to do something for the people and children of the area. So what he did was that he subscribed to many magazines, Time, Newsweek, Life, National Geographic, Sports Illustrated, Sports Star, huge number of magazines he would subscribe. And then he would by himself go and give it and collect it after 2 days, and we paid him a monthly sum for the magazines. But that was see, there were no libraries in those days. There was no internet. And I would never have come to know what all existed but for those magazines.
Really?
And that was the era of when cardiac surgery was at its peak. We had Barnard performing the open heart operation, Denton Cooley and DeBakey doing the CABG and other procedures. And so from a young age, I was fascinated with being a doctor. I wanted to be not only a doctor, I wanted to be a surgeon. I had not decided what surgeon, but I decided that I would be a surgeon someday. Very interesting that when I went for the interview, one of my classmates, who's the closest friend I have, he actually said, he is professor of neurosurgery at CMC Vellore. And on the day we went for the interview, when I said I would want to be a surgeon, he actually said at the age of 16 that he wants to be a neurosurgeon. And he became a neurosurgeon. So people get ideas from various places, and then they, so I got my idea. Seeing all these great heart surgeons, I thought I will be a surgeon, perhaps a heart surgeon. And also the fact that it seemed to me that in society, which may not be true today, but in those days doctors were held in respect. So I said, let me try. And unfortunately, we had this 11th standard school exam, and I didn't do well in it. I did very badly. In my school, every year we had one or two students who would come in the ISC, Indian School Certificate exam, in the top 10 ranks. And in our batch also, it was expected that we'll have one or two, and I was expected to be one of them. But, and we used to have a very tough pre-exam for our students. And I wrote the pre-exam like everybody else, and I actually got the highest marks ever awarded in our school for the pre-exam. So it seemed like I was a slam dunk for the getting a top rank. I actually did badly. I got a first class, but in ISC first class means nothing. So what happened is that in many places, the selection for the next level would be based on your school marks.
Right.
So now suddenly my horizons had narrowed, and CMC Vellore was one place where they didn't consider the school marks. They just needed that 40% or 50%, and the rest would be based on their exam and interview. Jipmer, 25% of the marks would be for the school marks and 75% would be for the entrance exam. So I knew that in Jipmer, I was unlikely to make it because my 25% would be very low. So I wrote these exams, and I also got admission to do pre-medical in one of the colleges, because what had happened at that time was that Tamil Nadu was still in the 5.5 year course, whereas in Delhi and everywhere they were in the 4.5 year course. So we still had to do physics, chemistry, biology in our first year. So I wrote the entrance exam, got selected for the interview in CMC, came for the interview, and I got selected for the seat as an open candidate. And within a week, though I didn't make it in the first list in the Jipmer exam, I got it in the second list because I had done the exam well. It was a multiple choice paper, I had written well, so I made up a lot of marks in that. So some of the people who had left, I got the leftover seats.
In Jipmer as
well. In Jipmer also.
Okay.
But Vellore was of course the more famous of the medical colleges. It was a college that had introduced cardiothoracic, neurosurgery, urology and whatnot to the country. So.
More than that, the same American culture which you had in your school has continued here.
To some extent. Mm. By the time I reached the MBBS, the American influence, we had a few professors who came from there. But by and large, Ida Scudder had passed away, so she was no longer there. We still had a lot of visitors, but it was not like before. We had one professor of surgery who was from Australia, but otherwise there was no other white.
But the attitude.
The attitude and the teaching was excellent.
Mm. I've heard that students call the professors by first name. Not so much.
We won't call them by their first name. That would be totally an American thing. We would still call them sir, but we were free to talk to them anytime we wanted, and we could question them.
That's right.
I could ask them that you are saying like this, but it is written in the book like this, and I have often questioned them, and they will accept. Right. So that culture was there. And of course, that culture of the CMC culture has always been of training the juniors. Okay. So even as an intern, you are given a lot of choices to and chances to do procedures. I still remember that after I finished my internship and then I got selected as a postgraduate at All India Institute, and I, about 2 weeks down the line, there was one patient who had a intricate in his fistula, and they had to put a central line. So when I asked the senior central line, what is happening, we have been ordered, we are not, he said, no, the city west people will come, then they will put. It was ordered in the morning at 8 o'clock. By 4 o'clock, the CTVS registrars had not turned up. So Vinay Kapoor was my final year PG, and he was, putting a central line, I have done quite a few in Vellore. If you don't mind, I can try, because we don't know when these people are going to come. So to his credit, he said, go ahead, try. So I put it in the first shot, and I taught other PGs how to put it. And you won't believe it that up to that time, central line, CTVS from every unit, they used to call the CTVS people to put the central line. From every unit, 4, 3, 2, they came to unit 1 to us to learn how to put a central line. I would go to their unit and demonstrate it for them once, then they would do it. And then by the time I left, the surgical department was putting their own central lines. So, and I owe that to the training that I got at CMC.
So what is what inspired you, or which surgeons inspired you in CMC Vellore?
Oh well, no question about who. It was Dr. Fenn, A.S. Fenn. He was a man larger than life. And he was a bachelor, very close to students. His house was next to the hostel.
Direct postgraduate under him?
No, I was not a postgraduate. I only did my undergraduate.
Oh, sorry, undergraduate.
Right. Undergraduate. Yes. I never did postgraduate.
That's
there.
Right, yeah. Mm.
So anybody could walk into his house, spend time and talking and everything. So, and he was this flamboyant surgeon, you know, fast, big incisions, and we were all fascinated. I think there's an entire generation of surgeons trained at CMC Vellore who became surgeons because of the flamboyance of Dr. Fenn. So he was definitely the surgeon who influenced me maximum.
Then how did you get into the All India Institute?
Well, I went and wrote the entrance exam.
But when it came to undergraduate, you were more focused on South India, CMC, Jipma.
Because when I did the undergraduate, I couldn't, to apply to All India Institute or other hospitals, I have to do 1 year of pre-medical.
Okay.
Whereas here, I did that right. Pre-medical as part of the MBBS course.
Okay, okay.
So I did a 5.5 year medical right. course, whereas in All India Institute is 4.5.
Okay.
When I was in my fourth year, CMC had also transitioned to the 4.5 medical course, and it became par with the rest of the country. So I applied in CMC Vellore. I did very well in the exam. I topped the exam, the entrance exam. But they have this policy of sponsorship and others. And one of my competitors was the best outgoing student of my batch. So it is obvious that nobody can deny the best outgoing student a seat. So I knew he would get it. But then that year they decided that of the 6 seats, 5 will be sponsored.
Oh, okay.
So I did not get in. I was first on the waiting list, but I did not make it. So then I came out and then went home because I had to vacate the place because I was no longer working there. And I went to, in those days in Tamil Nadu, you had these all medical colleges. You had to go individually to each medical college and attend an interview.
Okay.
And they will tape it because there was some court order that they have to tape right. it. And then they will put out a list after some time. And they will write the marks in pencil, not in pen. Because if you write in pen, you can't change the marks. Right. But in pencil, you can change the marks. Mm-hmm. So I went to Madurai. Tirunelveli, Tanjavur.
So many interviews.
Yeah, each hospital separate. Stanley, Madras Medical College, Kilpak Medical College. Each college separate interview.
Really?
Oh. Real. Mm. And you know, wherever I went, they asked why you didn't try in CMC. I told them I didn't get. Mm. They would laugh at me and say, "Now you want to get here, huh?" And obviously, I couldn't make it. So that time, the next entrance exams which came in May was PGI Chandigarh and CMC Vellore and AAMS. So my friend who had not gotten, he was from Delhi and he had an uncle in Chandigarh. So I went with him and we stayed at his uncle's house because I had no money to stay in a hotel and all that. And then I wrote the Chandigarh entrance exam. The Chandigarh entrance exam was the toughest exam I have ever written. It was 250 questions each with 5 choices, which means 1,250 choices. And in a question, you could have 1 right answer or 5 right answers. So you had to go and mark each one. And it was +1 for a right answer, -1 for a wrong answer. So my friend and I, we had marked a strategy. We'll only answer the question we are confident of. Anything else, we'll not up this thing. And we both did well in the entrance exam. In the entrance exam, I think he was second and I was third in the mark list of the entrance exam. And so both of us got what we wanted. But there was a problem with Chandigarh, that was that in those days, their course for surgery or anything, they will take 12 candidates in the first year. But they'll take only 6 into the second year.
Okay.
So you will be eliminated, 6 will be eliminated.
It was an American system.
Like American system. So okay. It was a pyramidal system. Pyramidal so system. They will eliminate.
Oh.
And if you...
is it there even now?
No, then it changed. It changed after about 4 or 5 years after we joined, then it changed.
Mm-hmm.
But HRMA, Shadash Chaudhary, they all went through that.
Really?
Oh. Yeah. So, I got in, I paid my fees. I had got surgery there. But then I came to All India Institute, wrote the entrance exam. Came home, waiting for the result. Because anyway, Chandigarh had said you join only on 1st of July. So my friend was in Delhi, went and saw the results, saw my name in the surgery list and immediately phoned me up. I had not expected to get into All India Institute. There was only 1 seat. They had 3 seats, but 2 were reserved for AIIMS graduates. So in a sense, you had to come first in the surgical list to get the seat. I had not expected. But somehow, I think some of my guests
were... But these entrances, did you prepare, find time to prepare during your undergraduation?
No, this is what I keep telling my students even today. That I studied medicine. I didn't study it to pass exams. So in my undergraduate days, while everybody is reading Satoshkar, I refused to read Satoshkar. I've never read Satoshkar. I read Goodman and Gilman. I read the first volume of Harrison about the symptoms and everything, and then parts of cardiology and neurology I read from Harrison. So surgery, of course, I read from Bailey and Love. Gynec, I read from some 2-3 books. So I used to read the standard textbooks. So pathology, I read from Robbins. So I think I prepared through my entire medicine to write entrance exams without knowing it. Because I read standard textbooks and I, fortunately, I have a fairly good memory, so I could retain it. And then, of course, when the exams came for Chandigarh and this thing, I was not working anywhere, so I was at home. So I used to sit at home, and there were some multiple choice books I used to work out, and then some books which I used to read, and many of them were very useful because some of the questions came directly from there, and that is how I wrote the entrance exam.
Was it a cultural shock in AIIMS? Because the system of working is different in CMC, the system in Delhi is different.
Well, to me, it was not a cultural shock. For one reason is that I knew Hindi. So, because I had spent 17 years in Bihar, I knew Hindi fluently. I could read and write. It was my second language. And the day I went, and when I introduced myself to the professor and the lecturer, and they said, "So where are you from?" I said, "From CMC Vellore." They both looked back and said, "Oh, we have to teach Hindi again to somebody." In Hindi, they told. And I immediately answered, "Hindi, no sir, I know Hindi very well." You could see the look of relief on their faces.
Really?
You know that this fellow knows Hindi and this thing. So to me, it was not a cultural shock. I was used to the diet of chapatis and other things also.
But the working pattern, the
philosophy. The working pattern was not very
CMC
different.
CMC and AIMS are more or less the same.
More or less the same working pattern. And very fortunate that we had Vinay Kapoor, who was 2 years my senior. He was my final year postgraduate. And he was a constant source of support, and he would support us. And he was very good. And we had a lot of hard-working All India Institute undergraduates who joined our departments. And so the working was not a problem. It was...
Which unit did you start?
82, July 1st.
Who is the chief of the unit?
The unit, I was attached to Unit 1, where Dr. Lalit Sharma was the chief. And Dr. T.K. Chattopadhyay was the assistant professor. So, in a way, I was very fortunate. Chattopadhyay was the young, aggressive surgeon, superb technique, and I learnt much of my operative technique with him. Whereas Dr. L.K. Sharma was laid back, but a superb judge of patients. To just give you an example, he will sometimes come, we'll post a case, and we'll say, tomorrow we have posted this case. He will look at the patient and say, why are you operating, you will die. He'll say like that. So then after he went off, then all of us say, he is an old man, he doesn't know anything. By 2 years, all of us realize that when he says he will die, he dies, the patient dies. That he is looking at things which we don't know to look for. So I started observing him closely, what he looks for. And then I could make out what he looks for. So that became, we had two different consultants, one who could teach us how to operate, one who could teach us when to operate, how to make decisions, and I think it was an ideal combination. Postgraduates, we are always carried away by the technique, but that is not enough. Decision making, that is more important, which our PGs don't realize. You must have the ability to make decisions. And even now I try to teach these boys how to make the decisions. When I make a decision, I tell them my reasons. Sometimes they'll be wrong, I will fail. But at least they know the reasons, and then they know that we failed, and then they'll ask me why. I'll say, maybe this is the way we failed. Next time we'll try something else. And as you become older, I think you also tend to become less aggressive. So if you look at our own unit, from the time I started doing laparoscopic surgery in 92, and if you look at the cholecystectomies, I don't think till 2004 or 5 I did a single percutaneous cholecystostomy. I would take all patients up for lap chole. But then since then I realized that many patients are unfit. They have just had an MI, they have had a stent put in. So these are patients ideal for PCT. And nowadays we do many more PCTs than we did in the past. So we have learned. I think that is the aim, that we should learn. And we should pass on that learning so that these people can convey it to other centers.
Other than Dr. Lalit Sharma and Dr. TKC and Senior Vinay Kapoor, who else really impressed you in the All India Institute?
Well, I think all of us were very impressed with Professor Nandi.
He was there?
Yeah, he was there. He was the Unit 4, this thing. He was a very impressive, tall figure, excellent English, done a lot of work, and he was an authority on portal hypertension. I think all of us were very impressed, and many of us wanted to be like him. There was also another surgeon in Unit 2 who was a plastic surgeon, who was called Naresh Madan, who was an excellent surgeon. And unfortunately, he developed inflammatory bowel disease, and they had to have an ileostomy and all that. But as far as hands were concerned, he was an outstanding surgeon. And because we were often operating in adjacent theaters, I would often go and visit them to see how they operated. There was one particular cardiothoracic surgeon, Dr. Sampath Kumar, who was very impressive, had very good hands. And I used to go and watch him closely to observe how he uses the instruments, what he does. And I developed a liking for how he operated.
What is the most effective way of utilizing your post-graduation time while working in institutions like All India Institute?
I think the most effective way is that you form a timetable in your mind. Many of us, what happens is that if the work is very hard, we tend to then just go and say, I'll go for a movie, I'll relax. Yes, you can do that. But do it once a week. But 5 times a week, you read. Don't try to keep everything to be read in 1 month before the exam. You read from day one and you keep reading it 2-3 times, you will remember it and it becomes part of you. So that is what I keep trying to tell my PGs, that from the day you come, you start reading. And in the initial period, you also read a lot of journals, because that will show you how people think, what all people think. And I have read articles which have left me wondering, how did this man ever conceive that he should study this? I recently read a paper where for CA rectum, they have looked at patients who had pathologically complete response. And they found that when they were operated, they have a higher leak rate and higher complication rate. Now, I don't know whether I would have even thought of this topic. But this man has thought of it in Netherlands. They looked at all their data and they have given us a clear message. Again, like there's a lot of work being done on this transanal TME. And last couple of months, there have been a lot of negative reports. And in this January BJS, the title of the topic is, Norway has suspended TATME for rectal cancer.
Really?
So they are. So you read that, then you read why, and then you realize that there are things beyond technique. We look at the technique shown by a surgeon in a workshop, and we all think we should do it. But when you look at the results later, you realize that it's inferior. So I think that they should read, and they should enjoy life. I'm not saying don't enjoy life, but limit it. You don't have to go for a movie every day. Once a week you go for a movie, eat out. Rest of the time you can sit in the evenings, read, you know. That is what I used to do. And I think I had a good training.
As a postgraduate, you think that reading is as important as practical?
Both are important. I think reading is important because you now want to know more of the indications. You want to know when to go in, when not to go in. And it is as important, and as you learn technique, you will realize that by reading you can apply these techniques. Maybe later I will tell you how I applied those techniques when I came to Meenakshi Mission Hospital, but you can apply those techniques.
Now, when you are doing your MS general surgery, the super specialties are not so very well developed as they are now. But did you ever think that you'll remain as a very good general surgeon?
I thought so. The options were pediatric surgery, neurosurgery, cardiothoracic surgery, urology. I was not very impressed with urology somehow, because the urology department in All India Institute was not that hot. Pediatric surgery was okay, but somehow I felt that most pediatric surgeons do childhood general surgery. They don't actually do the cusp, that is the neonatal surgery. So that put me off. And then neurosurgery, I simply didn't want to go. And cardiothoracic, I said no. Because in cardiothoracic, you're always stuck to a big hospital, big team. You need everything in position. So I said no, I won't do cardiothoracic surgery. So because of that, I refused.
These are all your thought processes or some mentor who's
No, these are all my these are all my thought processes. And I thought that I have done 3 years of post-graduation, but I thought that to be a complete surgeon. I mean, obviously in USA, a surgical training is 5 to 6 years. So I thought that it should be the same in India. So I thought that doing a senior residency in general surgery will be worth it. So I opted for the senior residency in general surgery as my first choice. And I got selected for that.
How did you move to Chennai?
I actually moved from All India Institute to Coimbatore.
Okay.
I spent about 9 months in PSG Institute of Medical Sciences.
Okay.
As an assistant professor in surgery.
Right.
At that time, my aim was that I will no longer be studying, that I will, my house financial situation was such that I thought I should start practicing.
You were married by then.
I was married by then, so start earning and support my own family and also help my father and everything. I was thinking of that. But when I landed up in PSG, I came across for the first time how it is to practice in the private sector. And I mean no insults or anything, but In the private sector, it's a different story. Practice depends not on your skills, but on your contacts. So those contacts could be college mates, it could be religious affiliations, it could be caste affiliations. And coming from a smaller caste, little forward caste, I found I couldn't get an attachment in any big hospital. Everywhere we go, give my application, they'll say they'll call back, they won't call back.
In spite of your CMC and AIMS background?
In spite of that. So, I was wondering what to do. And there was one surgeon in PSG who told me one day, when I was telling this in the OPD, he said, let us go for lunch. And we went for lunch to outside. And we while we were eating, he told me. He said, the practice in Tamil Nadu is not just in Coimbatore, everywhere is based like this. You are not from here, you are from, or not a, so you have every disadvantage. You are not a Coimbatore medical student, so you don't have your batchmates who can refer you cases. You are not a member of a majority community, so you will not get this thing.
Referral.
You are not a member of a minority community, so you won't get references. You are not a member of a major caste, you won't get references. So, to overcome this, you need to get further qualification. He told me. So that day I was thinking, and that day I came back, and a couple of days later all these people were filling up forms. I said, what forms are you filling? They said, we are filling for our MDMS and MCHDM forms. So one fellow was going to buy, so I gave him 100 rupees and said, please buy one form for me also. So the next day was the last day to receive. So that day I put the form, I took all the Xeroxes, I took the photograph, I posted it off. And I looked at the specialties, I saw MCH gastroenterology. I knew they had started an MCH gastroenterology because H. Ramesh and Ahmed Ali had visited All India Institute when I was a senior registrar in surgery.
Okay. Yeah.
So I had met them there. So it seemed to me that gastroenterology was the closest to general surgery, and so I decided to apply for that. So I applied for that.
Casually.
Casually. Mm. And meantime, I was trying to somehow hitch a ride to Saudi Arabia so that I could get some money so that I can go to UK to write FRCS exam and work there. That was not working out. So I went to Madras, wrote the entrance exam, and on the same day I received a telegram asking me to come to the embassy in Saudi Arabia to get my certificates verified. I went there by train, I verified my certificates, and then I came back. About 3 months later, the MCH results were published, and almost simultaneously I got a letter from Saudi Arabia asking me whether I would like to join. When the MCH results were published, I looked at the roll number that was there. I thought, this looks like my roll number. I then pulled out my hall ticket. It was my number. So then I rang up 3-4 people who are close to me and asked them, should I go to Saudi or should I go and do the MCH? Without any hesitation, all of them said, you should do MCH. In Saudi, you are still going to get money, you are going to go for
an
FRCS.
Whom did you ask?
I asked my aunt, a couple of friends.
Right.
So I asked Chatterjee. So all of them said, do MCH. So I joined for MCH and Surendran was my classmate. And we spent 2 years. You know, you have been there, that you don't learn much, but at least you have a degree at the end of it. That's all that mattered. That you needed a degree.
What is your equation with Professor NR? How was it?
When I first joined, NR ignored me completely. And I was always in the periphery, and me and so
on. How can anyone ignore you?
I mean, I was also told by everybody that keep your trap shut. So I used to keep my trap shut. And Alaganandam and Palani Velu had failed the first time. And their second exam had come up. When their second exam came up, we were standing waiting for the examiners to come. The first examiner to walk in was Professor Prakash Kanduri, who was my professor in CMC Vellore in surgery. So he looked at me and said, Ramesh, tu kya kar raha? What are you doing here? Then he just put his arm around my shoulder and took me into NR's room.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And then introduced me to NR and said, he is my student, he's a very bright student, he's a good student, all that. Then somehow I escaped and came out. Another 10 minutes later, Chandramohan and Ratnasamy brought in BML Kapoor.
Okay.
As soon as he saw me, he called me, hey Ramesh, tu kya kar, what are you doing here? come. And he took me to Dr. Rangabhashyam. And he said, this is my student from Holland Institute. He's a very bright boy, very good student. That day, I saw that there was a change in Professor Hina's attitude towards me. He was no longer as hostile, and he would ask me questions, and I would ask him questions, and we became better. And then, of course, time went on. And of course, there were people who would try to create trouble. That is natural. We try to avoid that trouble.
Is anything you learned in terms of the newer technology? Or
no, what I learned from Dr. Rangabhashyam more than newer technology was documentation. He was passionate about that. So everything had to be photographed. So when I came here and I started doing my cases, I bought a camera and I used to photograph all my, because that is what you can show to others.
Right.
And a photograph speaks like a million words. And so I learned documentation as an important part of this thing. And I learned from him also that we must attend conferences and that we must get up in conferences and make comments, and you should make your presence felt. Because when you make your presence felt, there will be others from your area who will see you, and then they will say, this fellow talked, he might know something. So they will refer some patients to you. So I realized that. So I think these two things were very important things that I learned from Professor Enna. And I think all of us, including Surendran, every one of us learnt these two things, that we should document and present and attend conferences. And if you see, for the first, say, 15 years of surgical gastroenterology conferences, the faculty used to be entirely NR faculty. It used to be Palnivelu, H. Ramesh, Ahmad Ali, Surendran, Ramesh Arthanari, Chandramohan, Ratnasamy. It used to be that, used to be the fact.
But it's the same even now. I think now when, if it comes south, there are only two Rameshes anybody can talk of for the last about three decades.
Yeah.
There's no new names are come up.
No, there are too many people, I think, and the work is divided. So we were fortunate. So again, we were fortunate in that we were at the vanguard. So we got a lot of cases. So, in Meenakshi Mission Hospital now, we have done more than 1,000 Bipuls. We have done about 800 Frays. So we were lucky. It is difficult for a student who comes now to start practice to achieve those numbers. Because when I did Bipuls, nobody would do in Madurai. Now there are 20 people to do. So I think that is the reason why they will, this thing. Plus, most of them are hesitant to speak. I keep telling them, go and speak. They say, no, we won't speak.
When you are there.
Not when I'm there, otherwise also in the meeting, they are a little hesitant to speak. I mean, I never criticize anybody. You have seen me. I never criticize anybody. I never tell them you spoke.
I mean, there's a very special thing about you. As one of the surgical gastroenterologists, I can say that you never downplay anyone. You are never sarcastic. That's a very special trait. How could you do that? Because you see some nonsense being done by somebody, but you will not call it nonsense.
I won't call it nonsense, because that is, if you call it nonsense, you immediately make an enemy out of him. So I will tell them that I don't agree with it. So, and tell them, and then there will be, when we tell that, there will be in an audience of 200 people, say maybe 100 people who will at least listen to what I am saying and say that, yeah, he is right, there is logic in it. But if you try to downplay him and say something, everybody gets, little uncomfortable, and then, you get a bad name. And so generally I don't try to criticize people roughly. And I try to guide them in the right way. Sarcasm, because I have been at the end of sarcasm many times in my life as a student, because I used to be fat. I used to be a good student, and good students often get sarcastic remarks. Teacher ka chamcha hai, in Hindi they will say. So all that was, so I never wanted to hurt another person. As a matter of fact, I was a vociferous anti-ragging person in the hostel. And there were a lot of people who gave me threats and all in those days, because I was vociferous, I used to speak. Okay. That no, we should not do ragging.
What is your special bond with Dr. Surendran?
Surendran is because we did together. But more than that, he guided me. So on the very first day, he told me that, look, I know you would have done a lot of surgery in All India Institute, but don't tell them here that you have done this, you have done that, you can do this. Just keep quiet. They will unnecessarily put you down. Then he used to say also that, and then I used to, in the first 2 days, when they were eating lunch, I used to go to the canteen to eat lunch because I was living alone. Then he asked me, where are you going? I said, I'm going to the canteen to eat lunch. And he said, no, no, come, come, we'll share the lunch. And we shared his lunch. From the very next day, for the next 2 years, till we finished the course, he would always bring two tiffin carriers, one for him and one for me. His wife would pack two carriers.
Very tasty food, that is.
Huh?
Food is very tasty.
And tasty. And every day. Mm. I mean, that was something that is our special bond. And of course, we had similar thoughts. We were both academically interested. We used to read hard. We used to discuss cases, discuss points. So suppose one is academically good, but the other is not, then you know, you lose interest. But here, there was a good interaction between us. So that was my special bond, and it continues to this day.
But how did you manage monetarily? Because they are paid a pittance while doing MCA.
Well, I managed by, when I was in All India Institute, we used to be paid a little bit better. So I had saved some money, and I bought a fridge and a TV and other things. So when I came and these things, so I would every 3 months sell something and then continue. And then my parents helped me out a little bit. My aunt helped me out a little bit. So I got some money, and somehow I managed to get through that 1.5-2 years. But it was, as you said, it was difficult monetarily. I couldn't have any extravagances. So you asked me about my special bond with Surendran. There's one more reason for that bond. In 1988, we went for the ESICON in Delhi.
Okay.
And it was, I think, the Platinum Jubilee at ESICON in Delhi. Mm. And Surendran was there, I was there. And Surendran's classmate in MS, who worked at, in those days, he used to have a hospital and was working at Teni, which is close to here. Mm-hmm. His name was Ram Kumar. He was a surgeon. So he introduced me to Ram Kumar, and we became friends. At that time, Ram Kumar asked me, are you in service? Are you going to be posted somewhere? I said, no, I'm not in service. I'm a private candidate. Then he said, I have a friend who is building a big hospital in Madurai. He has a plan for gastroenterology. I would like you to meet him. So that day, I was introduced to Dr. Sethuraman by Ram Kumar. And he asked me what, and I said, I got one more year, 90 I will finish. Then 89 December I will, or 90 April I will finish, and then I can this thing. So he took my name and address on a small white piece of paper, put it in his purse, and said, I'll contact you. The way he put it, I didn't think he would contact me, but promptly about a year later in December, I got a letter from him asking me to come to Madurai for an interview to meet. So I came here, and when I came here, he said, as soon as I sat down in front of him and the other two people, he said, look, Dr. Ramesh, this is not an interview, because we have seen your qualifications, we have already selected you, only whether you want to work with us. We are a new hospital, and this. So many people asked me later, why did you go to a new hospital? I felt that if you grow with a hospital, you can do things your way and mold people, junior to you, and have a department. And so I decided to join this new hospital, which had just been opened, not yet opened in December when I came. I joined on April 24th when it was opened, and we had, from his nursing home, 20 patients who were shifted here, and we started working. We had only two floors, one.
But joining here is bold from the blue. When you're doing a 2 year course in Madras, you're not a native like Dr. Surendran.
No.
You're the, as your friend in Coimbatore said, you don't have any of the positive attributes which you require in private practice. Weren't you unsettled or unsure as to what you're going to do further? What other options did you keep?
So I was thinking of other options. I visited some hospitals in Chennai. Huh. And when I visited those hospitals, I won't name them, they asked me to buy shares worth 1 lakh or 2 lakhs. Mm. I had no money. Mm. So I couldn't join them with a share. And they said, we won't.
If you had joined, the history would have been different.
Maybe. See, you can always look back in life and say if you joined. But then there were practical problems. I didn't have the money. Mm. And in those days, it was not easy to get loans like now. Right. So it would have been difficult. And this was an opportunity because new hospital, there were no big hospitals in Madurai at that time. The biggest hospital was Vadamalayan, which was a hardly 50-bedded hospital. So whereas in Madras, I would have to compete with Rangavashyam and Krishna Rao and all the big jambavans of surgery. Same in Delhi or in Mumbai. But in Madurai, nobody else had an MCH. So, and as I felt that the MCH would help me to overcome the disadvantages I told you earlier. And it did. Because I started getting references. And of course, I went and met a lot of people. Every weekend, we would be on the road with one marketing department, going from here to Thoothukudi, Nagarkoil, visiting surgeons, leading physicians, practitioners, and introducing.
What is your selling point?
Selling point was that I have got these training, I have come here, we have got endoscopes. If you think you cannot manage it here, we will be happy to help you. That is all I said, because I didn't want to insult them by saying you send me the cases. I said, if you think you can't manage. And I had some two or three people said, what is there in MCH? We also do GJs. I said, yes, you also do GJs. I'm not telling you to send me those. If there's a problem, you don't feel like managing because it's a VIP or because the problem is complex, I'm there to help you. I will this thing. So that is how I try to sell.
One other interesting point we often discuss is, was your wife okay with your joining, coming to Coimbatore? Because she's been Mumbai.
Coimbatore, she was okay because they're also from Tirchi area, so she was okay. But she's basically from Bombay. They did want that if I can get a job in Bombay. Mm. But I did try for some jobs in Bombay. Mm. My father's owner of the company is a very powerful man in Bombay. He belongs to the Kapadia group. Mm. So he said, I'll talk to you separately without your father and your father-in-law, because they both worked in the same company. He said, Bombay is different. And he said, if you're good at your job, you'll get a lot of patients. But some of the others, they may even hire a hitman to kill you. This is the way it goes here. So, I won't advise you to come to Bombay. You are not a native of Bombay. If you are native of Bombay, you would have gone with that group. You would have had friends who will protect you. You would have had a group that is with you. Everything would have been on. Now you are coming in new. And I would strongly advise you not to come in and join. If you want, I can get you a job. He knew the owners of Bombay Hospital and he could get me. But when he warned me like that, I felt a little this thing. So, and also, I thought coming back to Tamil Nadu, I'm a Tamilian, I speak Tamil, so coming back to my own place was more comfortable.
So when you came as a GA surgeon to Madurai, the initial response from general surgeons is not very
favorable. No, it was not at all.
They will refer you secondary liver or something like that.
So the way to what I did was that, fortunately, Dr. Sethuraman was giving me a fixed salary per month. So I could live on that. I had enough money to be comfortable. So I would talk to the doctors. I would tell them, I'm sorry, but this patient, I can't do much. He's got secondaries or he's got an advanced cancer. I don't want to do much and things like that. So I would tell them openly and then send the patient. And I made it very sure that I sent the patient back to them.
Okay.
So that was that I learned from Dr. Sethuraman, that you must send the patient back.
Okay.
And Dr. Sethuraman gave us a lot of tips in the early months how to practice, and he would often tell us, if your patient is 50% sick, tell them he's 80% sick. In All India Institute, we were taught if he's 50% sick, tell him he's not sick. Hmm. But here they didn't. He said, you tell him he's 80% sick, because if he dies, he will not blame you. But if he survives, he'll be forever grateful. Hmm. So that is one of the tips. And one day he told me while we were traveling, he said, if you have managed a death properly, that family will come back to you. Don't worry, you won't lose the family. And I've seen it over the last few years that I've seen some of the patients dying, or I've told them bad prognosis, they come back to me. And the one thing they all tell me is that last time you told he will live only 1 month, don't spend money. He lived 1 month, they spent money. You have told them don't spend money, but they spend money. But we know you will tell the truth. That is why we have brought him here. So you can, actually I learned a lot from Dr. Sethuraman in the art of practice. And unfortunately they don't teach that in the colleges. And it is something that should be taught.
What is a foray into endoscopy? Why did you get into endoscopy?
That's a very interesting story. What happened is that when I joined here, Dr. Sethuraman had added an entire group of endoscopes. At that time, it was the single largest order of endoscopes in India to Olympus company. We had ordered an upper GI scope.
What confidence did he have to order?
He was building a new hospital. He ordered it in for gastroenterology department. And somebody advised him and he ordered. We had an upper GI scope, a therapeutic upper GI scope, a colonoscope, a side viewing scope, a bronchoscope. We had heater probe. We had a laser machine and multiple accessories. Mm. Those accessories like guide wires and cameras lasted me for about 3 to 4 years. Mm. That many he had bought even in the first time. So we had a lot of these lying around. Now there was a gentleman who was from here who was supposed to do the endoscopy, but he had his own busy practice. So he would only come in the evenings, and many of our patients will come in the mornings. Mm-hmm. And I told Dr. Sethuraman that what should I do, because patients are unwilling to wait. He said, "You do the endoscopy, don't bother." I said, he objects. He said, "Don't worry, I will manage." So I start. So I have never touched an endoscope before that. Mm. Well, let me be very frank, I never touched an endoscope. So first thing I did was I went and bought from the Madurai Medical College library stores. Peter Cotton's practical endoscopy, and I read how to do an upper GI scopy, and the next day I started doing upper GI scopy. First 2-3 cases was difficult, but then within a month I was very confident of upper GI scopy.
Self-learned.
Then I decided that now I've done upper GI scopy, colonoscopy is lying there, let us. So I read again colonoscope from Cotton, and I started doing colonoscopy. In a year, I had done upper GI scopy and colonoscopy, and I was very confident of doing both. At that stage, ERCP was in its infancy in India, and there was no place I could actually train very well. And so I decided that if I have done upper GI scopy and endoscopy, might as well do ERCP also. So I read, at that time I bought another book called Michael Sivak, Gastrointestinal Endoscopy, very good book. I read both of them, all the topics on how to put the scope in, how to turn, everything. And on the first case, it took us 2 minutes for me to put the, 2 hours for me to put the cannula into the ampulla and take a cholangiogram. But that seeing that cholangiogram and the feeling I had, I have had it only once before when I did my first lap coli. Only 2 times I've had that feeling. It was an absolute feeling of elation that I have cannulated the bile duct. And then swiftly we started doing, and then I started attending endoscopy conferences and I started doing. It was at that time in 91 November that there was a joint meeting of the Royal College of Surgeons of England and the ASI in Delhi. So I went to attend that conference. So in the main hall, you had people speaking on IBS and IBD. You had John Alexander Williams and, you know, the great names of from Japan and all speaking in the main halls. There was one small room where barely 20 people could sit. And a TV was playing there. And there were hardly 3 people watching. I went and sat and watched. And that was the first time I saw a lap coli. And that was being done with a laser by a gentleman who is from Madurai, who was a partner in the laser firm, M.Y. Shankar. So I introduced myself to him and I talked about it. And to me, it seemed that this is the future. Somehow, it struck me that this is something that we are going to have as an important thing. So when I came back, I told Dr. Sethuraman, I think we should invest in laparoscopy. He said, we have no money. So a couple of months went by and everybody in India was buying Stores or Esculap. These are the 2 common companies. So there was a gentleman, Ramanathan, who was a agent representative for Stryker, who came and met me. The same Ramanathan, 30 years later, he became managing director of Car Stores India and whatnot. He came to me and said, Stryker also, we have this. And I knew that Stryker is a well-known company. So I said, and fortunately what happened is that while he was practicing in Munichale, because he wanted to do cystoscopy and all with a camera, chairman had bought one metal halide light source, a camera from Stryker, and kept it. which was not being used. So all I needed was some instruments. So I told him, look, this is all I need. Work out how much. It came to about 8 lakhs. I said, we'll pay you over 6 months. Every month we'll pay you a certain amount. Will you? He went back, talked, and he said, okay. Then that day next day he brought a demo set. And I called my urology colleague Raja and Murri and told them, look, you fellows have done a lot of endoscopic surgery. I have never done endoscopic surgery. Please assist me. So they assisted. I did the lap coli. Before that, I had gone once to Coimbatore where I watched Professor Krishna Rao do a lap coli.
Okay.
Live. I have not assisted anybody. And on the night before the operation, I read Udvadia's book on lap coli. And there were two videos from Johnson & Johnson which I watched completely. And then I did the lap coli. It took us 2 hours. But we completed it safely. And we finished it. My greatest pleasure was that not only I finished it, when I finished it, the person from Stryker who had brought the demo came to me and said, sir, you would have done about 20-30 cases before? I said, no, this is my first case. He was very impressed. So that is how I started. So upper GI scopy, colonoscopy, ERCP and laparoscopy, all I learned on my own.
If you really look at it, a lot of surgeons who took to endoscopy became endoscopists and left surgery. I mean, you are the one who was into high-end endoscopy, high-end laparoscopy. Your contemporaries who started laparoscopy, very, very few could and continue to be so. I mean, you continue to be a hardcore open surgeon, continue to be hardcore. I mean, this is something very, very strange.
Yeah, so open surgery has always been my first love. I am a surgeon, so doing open surgery was always my first love. And then I think that laparoscopy was my second love. And I saw that laparoscopy had abilities. And one of the reasons why we saw that it could do was the advent of the harmonic scalpel. That we now had a method where we didn't rely on just clips and things, the harmonic scalpel. Now you would probably remember that we were the first hospital in India to buy the harmonic scalpel.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And I still remember the day when Narayan Babu of Ethicon came to me to sell the harmonic scalpel. He didn't have a model. He just had a video and a thing. I went with that and we showed it to our chairman. Our chairman is a urologist. He's a surgeon. So he saw that and then he told Narayan Babu very prophetic words. He said, Mr. Babu, if what you're showing me on the screen is actually what the machine is capable of, you're not talking of selling 4 or 5 machines a year. But you are talking of selling 400 or 500 machines a year. And that was prophetic because that is how much they sell now.
Really?
And he saw that and I said, this I think will help us. He immediately placed the order. No demo, nothing, no negotiation. He immediately placed the order and told Narayan Babu, I'll give you a check if you want right now. Narayan Babu said, no, I'll go back, get the invoice and then we'll take the check. So we were the first in the country to install it. And a matter of pride that from Palani Velu to Pradeep Chaube to everybody, they came and asked me on the phone whether it's worth it, whether it is really good. So that somebody from Madurai, a second-rate city, could tell somebody in Delhi and Bombay that something is worth buying was some matter of great pride. So that is why, and of course, endoscopy, I did because there was no endoscopist. Right. Perhaps if there had been a medical gastroenterologist, I wouldn't have gone into endoscopy. But then I went into it and over the last 20 years, I have trained many medical gastroenterologists in endoscopy. They have come here and they come and tell me, we have no ERCP experience. I say, you do, we will let you do. And they all learn and then they become experts, they go out and practice. Then we bought EUS and many of them have learned EUS and gone and become experts. And Ravindranath always tells me, I look for Meenakshi Mission Hospital. Whenever I need a gastro, I first look at Meenakshi because I know they are well trained and have done a lot of patients. And I can catch them, they can do the procedures very well. So we have given global and MIOT and global Bangalore, lot of medical GE, surgical GE people who have done good work. So that is how... So endoscopy was never, so now I don't do much of endoscopy. Once in a while a patient says, no, you must do, I go and do it. Or I find that poem the others are not confident of doing, I go and do the poem. So those are the only two things I do. Otherwise, ERCP, cystogastrostomy, all that I am now left to the medical and my junior surgical colleagues. They do it. I don't go anywhere near it. They let them do it. I still do a lot of laparoscopy and open surgery. But by and large, restricted to these two.
So I taken much of your time and dragged you past lunch, and I have one last question before wind up. See, you have a team which has stayed with you for long. How was that possible? Because keeping one team in a place, you know, what is the secret?
I think I've been lucky, but the most important thing is, I think, is respect. You have to give your colleagues respect.
What do you mean by that?
You have to respect them as a doctor. You have to give them independence. And tell them, do this. If you have a problem, you can call me, but do what you want. So I have trained my juniors to do what they want. And I have given them small subspecialities into which I don't even go. So Mohan does looks after the liver transplant program. I am not involved in it at all. I only sign the official document as medical director.
Right.
Whether the patient is canvas, what they do, who does, he does. And Srinivasan does. Bose does bariatric surgery. I don't go near bariatrics. If the patient comes for me for bariatric, I refer it to him. So you have to encourage people to do something and you have to give up some things.
Right.
And also you
it's
have
not
to,
easy.
It's not easy. And also sometimes what you have to give up is that you have to give up some money. So, the hospital will give you a certain amount of money to the department. Now, if the senior man says, no, I want all the money, the hospital has to give the juniors, the hospital may start. So, then you have to say, no, okay, I will take a 10% cut. We will make it up over the years. You give it to them, then they will bring cases and we will make it up over the years. So we have to do that.
Generosity.
So you have to do that. So there was a time when I used to get 100% of the incentives in the department. Now I get only 50%. I give the other 50% to the others. So unless you give that, they won't stay. But I think that people forget that respect is more important than even money. Respect that they have a standing.
Right.
That they have a standing. I think that is what is important.
Being administrator is another feather in your cap. You enjoy being an administrator.
Yes, except when it comes to. Having to dismiss somebody or scold somebody, then it becomes a little difficult. But then somebody has to do it. Because so we have rules. Like we have rules that you shouldn't practice outside. It should be full time. That's why we give them a minimum assured salary. But they still go and practice outside. So then we call them once, we warn them, twice we warn them. Third time we tell them that, okay, we'll part as friends. So they get upset, why are you asking me to leave? And they go out and foul mouth us. But then they don't remember that we have got an agreement that you are a full-timer. See, if a nephrologist practices outside in his clinic, it's okay for us because he will bring the patient here for a transplant, he will bring the patient here for dialysis.
Right.
So we get money. But if the ENT surgeon or the orthopedic surgeon practices outside, then we are losing that patient. We are losing all that money. And slowly there will come a time when they think that the hospital is not bothered, they may even tell a patient here, you come there.
Right.
So we don't want that. And we have tried to develop. And I think that one of the reasons we have been successful in Meenakshi Mission Hospital, which we are more successful than even Velamal or others, is we have an occupancy rate of about 90%. We have about 750 patients now. Is because we have full-time consultants. So everybody comes at 9 in the morning and is there till 6 in the evening.
Right.
So, and plus we give them a lot of facilities. We give them a driver, we give them one international conference a year, fully paid for up and down, room rent, registration. We give them one national conference, one state conference, so three conferences a year they can attend without papers. If they have papers, then if the paper is good and they can come to me and I can give a special sanction. So many advantages we give. I don't think any private hospital will give this foreign conferences and all that. So when we give them all this, we expect something in return.
So certainly.
That you are a little sincere.
So it's been wonderful talking to you, sir, and I hope on another day I'll catch up with you and talk about surgical training.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks for your time.